as you take your seats. I simply entitled it Christ's Legacy for Leaders. Christ's Legacy for Leaders. It's as we close out John's writing, his epistle that the Holy Spirit inspired through the Holy Spirit to give to us today. There's so much that we can learn from this particular encounter, and we've taught on this before, but there's so much to learn from this time where Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, is now appearing to his disciples, as the text tells us, for the third time. And it's a powerful encounter on how you get to see and experience not only the hand of God, but you get to see and experience the heart of God and the wisdom of God being demonstrated in front of us, along with the sovereignty and power of God. It's just a beautiful encounter. The storyline opens up in chapter 21, leading in by telling us that that Jesus, after these things, Jesus was seen and revealed himself to the disciples on the Sea of Tiberias. And the disciples have now, Peter has now said to them, I'm going fishing. I'm going to take care of the business that I'm trained to do. I'm going to get back into the livelihood that I'm familiar with, that I'm trained in, and I'm experienced at. And the disciples say to Peter, we're going with you. And so they cast out, the text tells us. And while they're out there, fishing overnight, which sounds very familiar, they caught nothing. And as they're looking and they're thinking to themselves, they spot Jesus on the shoreline. And therein is the conversation that we enter into in verse 5. It says, as the morning was breaking, Jesus came to the beach and stood there, and disciples did not know it was Jesus. And the Amplified says, so Jesus said to him, children, have you caught anything to eat with bread? You do not have any fish, any meat, do you? They answered him, no. And Amplified says, he said to them, cast that net on the right side of the boat, and you shall find some. They cast the net, and now they were not able to haul it in for such a great catch, such a great quantity and mass of fish that it was. Here's what I want you to, out of this first segment of the chapter, here's what I'd like you to take away, if you don't mind, from the life lessons. The first one is simply this. When Christ calls us to lead, he reminds us of our life preparation and his teaching. He renews our heart for fellowship and for service. And he removes our fears of weakness and failure when Christ calls you to lead. When he calls you to lead. Notice the storyline. Notice how things take place. I love how Jesus, in the process of appearing to them this third time, he comes to the setting that is very familiar to them in a situation and steps into the area of their inadequacy. Can I say it that way? Of their weakness, of their lack, and begins to speak into that with his heart and hand of care and abundance. And you can just, if you can just imagine what it must have been like for the disciples seeing Jesus on the side of the beach, on the beach, and not necessarily recognizing them, but hearing that powerful and familiar voice asking them the question, have you caught anything yet? You've been toiling all night. You've been doing what you do. You've been working in your own strength. You've been working in an area that you feel comfortable with. You've been working in what you think intellectually is an area that you know something about. It's your livelihood. It's been your profession. It's been what you do. But you now have experienced 3+ years of walking with the Savior. You've now seen him heard him speak like no man has ever spoken before. You now have seen him perform miracles like no man has ever performed before. You've now seen him have control over the seas and the land, control over demons, control over the winds and the waves. You've seen him heal like no man has ever healed before. And now you've seen him standing in front of you alive, raised from the dead. And is there anything that you lack that you don't think God can handle in your life? It's as if he's now like opening up the vision gates and taking them back and relating them to what they have seen before. You remember. You have to remember that we've had this conversation before. We've been down this road before. You've been out fishing before and you caught nothing. You've heard me say to you before, cast the net on the other side. And Peter would have said, well, you know, Lord, I've done this before. I've been here before and I've caught nothing casting my net. And to have Jesus say, yeah, but cast it on the side where I tell you to cast it to, in the way that I tell you to cast it, in obedience to the way I want you to cast it, and then watch, oh, somebody's about to get this now, and then watch what God does. Talk to me if you've ever been in a situation where you cast your net on your own side of the boat, only to find out by trying to do it in and of your own strength, only by trying to go back to what's familiar to you in your flesh. Can I talk to somebody like we're family today? Only by trying to muscle up a blessing and try to fulfill your own needs, you found out that you always fall short of the glory. You always fall short of the ideal blessing. Y'all talk to me, church. You always fall short of the ideal that God has for you when you try to cast your net on your side. But do you notice? Have you ever noticed how God is so loving and so gracious, and he just never gives up on us, even when we try to do our own thing, even when we try to go our own way, even when we unintentionally try to take things into our own hands and handle them by ourselves. When God is calling us into leadership, and we all have some role to play in proclaiming this good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ, watch how he comes alongside where we are, steps into the situation that we're in, reminds us that he has been preparing us all along for this day and been teaching us into us. So it's not like you're on the boat for the first time. And it's not like you're alone in the midst of the process. And taking us back to the recognition that he alone is God. Cast it on the right side, he says to them. And the text tells us that when they were obedient to the Lord, the blessings overflowed in their lives. I believe the text tells us to the point that, you know, it just overflowed their nets. And I'm having this picture as Jesus is now sitting on the side. The text, as you read down through those scriptures, it tells us he says to him, bring your fish in here. Bring your fish to the table. He's sitting on the side with a campfire going on. He said, bring what I have created. Bring what I have blessed you with. Bring what in your obedience you now have received from the blessing God has given you. Bring the fruits of the labor, the blessing through you and the labor that has resulted in our working together in this. Because Jesus had told him, you shall be fishers of men. Bring the symbolic catch and bring it on in here and put it down and let's dine together. He brings us when we're in a place where our hearts may be sinking, when our minds may be confused, and our situation may seem uncertain. And he has this beautiful way, family, of stepping into that. He comes into that and pulls up a seat with us and walks along with us, and at the same time blesses into us as we obey him and he gives us wisdom. It's a powerful thing. I love it. The guys in the cave come to realize that it's the Lord as you read down through that. And then the symbolism or the imagery, if you will, of them dragging the net. It says in verse 11 that the net was full of large fish, 153 of them. And there were so many of them, and yet the net was not torn. They're dragging their fish up to the breakfast nook. And Jesus does this. Don't miss this. The one who is the creator of the universe, the one who's demonstrated power in his earthly walk like no man has ever seen before, wisdom like no man has ever seen before, words, miracles, supernatural acts like no man has ever seen before, has now just performed a supernatural act in their lives that helps them to connect their earthly walk and the message he had for them when they were walking with him to the message he's now about to give them as they're about to go out and represent him. He now pulls them up to him and serves them. This is a foot washing moment. Are you catching this? This is a drop your apron type, get on your knees and bless them type of a moment. It's restoring them. It's restoring their sense of their who-ness. It's restoring their understanding of the purpose. And it's getting down in front of them and said, this is what servant leadership looks like. And in the midst of the conversation, he takes the bread and he blesses it, and he takes a fish and he gives it to them, and he says, eat. Now, if you are a disciple, what goes through your mind if you see Jesus begin to hand out fish and bread? You've just seen him go through the casting the net on the right side, and now he sits down with you lovingly, caringly, inspirationally, motivationally, and he lifts their hearts, takes them out of their sense of lack, moves them into abundance, takes them out of their sense of worry, moves them into security, takes them out of their fear about what might be coming, and erases it and gives them a sense of comfort. And now says, pull up a table, pull up the table, pull up a seat, men, pull up a seat, and let me serve you. Bring what you have and let me serve you. And they have to be thinking in their minds, at least if I'm sitting around the table with Jesus, my mind is beginning to just get filled up with the memories of the things of the journey and the walk that I've had with him. My mind is beginning to overflow with the good times and the blessed times. Yeah, I saw him on the cross with his hands strung out there. Yes, I saw what it looked like when he gave his life on the cross for your sins and for mine. But yes, indeed, I saw him resurrected and walking on the roadside. And now he takes me back to let me know that if I'm going to be a fisher of men, then it cannot be in and of my own strength. It's not my ability to catch fish that makes me an effective fisher of men. It's my ability to walk with Jesus and watch how he brings the fish to be caught. And I begin to see baskets, and I begin to see little lad with baskets in his hands, and I begin to reflect back and think, now wait a minute, the same God who took that and fed 5,000 men and all those women and children is now sitting across from me, and he says, take this fish and eat it. Take this bread and eat it. And without saying a word, he is putting me in a place where my mind is beginning to understand, if I'm sitting beside these men, that something greater, he's called us to something greater than we are. So when he calls you to lead, he reminds us of the preparation that he's placed, the journey, the walk with him that has prepared you and me for this moment in time. And that's important. We're not randomly dropped into this moment and said, now go make it work. You've got a life journey. There are a whole lot of relationships, a whole lot of avenues you've walked, a whole lot of mistakes we've made and successes that we've had, a whole lot of friends that we've had and friends that we've lost. There's a whole lot of fear that has tried to fall down on us, and a whole lot of comfort that has come on top of us when we've given it to the Lord. There's a whole lot of struggle that we've been through, and yet there's a whole lot of victory that we're walking in. And in the midst of that, all of that, God is using all of that for his glory and our good to prepare us for this moment in time. And he's teaching us all along. And in the midst of that, he's renewing our hearts for fellowship and service. He's enlarging us. This is bigger than you. This is not about power. This is about service. And so, you know, all that other stuff comes alongside when you humbly serve. Don't worry about that. That's not important. That's short term. That's transitional. That's in this earth realm. When you get into glory, none of that's going to be important to the Lord. So just serve. Just follow me. And he just removes our fears for weakness and failure. And then I picked up with this next episode, which is very familiar to you in this chapter. It's when he has this conversation in verse 15 with Simon Peter. You know this, but I just want to touch it for us. Amplified says, when they had eaten, Jesus says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these others do? Amplified says, with reasoning, intentional, spiritual devotion, as one loves the Father. He says to Jesus, yes, Lord, you know that I love you, that I have a deep, instinctive personal affection for you, as for a close friend. In other words, Jesus is saying to you, do you agape love me? Paul says, I filio love you. And do you love me unconditionally, sacrificially? Peter says, I love you like a brother. And again, he said to him in verse 16, the second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? With reasoning, intentional, spiritual devotion, as one loves the Father. And he says to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you, that I have a deep, instinctive, personal affection for you as a close friend. He said to him, shepherd, tend my sheep. He said the first one, feed my sheep. He says, tend my sheep. And then 17, Amplified says, he says to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me with a deep, instinctive, personal affection for me as for a close friend? Peter was grieved, took it ill that he should ask him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you, that I have a deep, instinctive, personal affection for you as a close friend. And Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. The second life lesson in this, when God calls us to leadership, is this. When God calls us to lead, he covers our faults with his grace and mercy. Somebody wanted to say amen right there. And he clarifies his kingdom purpose and vision and inspires us to follow him. This is a very personal encounter, but it has such a very wide-ranging application, for lack of a better way to put it. Because you know the storyline of Simon Peter. You know that Jesus is asking him three times. He's restoring him, as you might have a header in your Bible. Restoring his faith, restoring his confidence, restoring the man, building into him the understanding that God's grace and mercy is greater than any sin that we can commit. And so Peter, who has denied, you remember the Peter story. Peter comes to Jesus and basically, pastor's paraphrase, and basically says, you know, Lord, I am your committed one. I'll stand with you, even if the rest of these brothers, if they forsake you. Jesus tells him that Satan desires to sift you and weep. But when you have been converted, then you need to then go and lift up and lead and convert the brethren. And he tells him that you will deny me three times when the pressure comes, when I come to the point where I'm giving my life, where I'm going and stretching out my arms to give my life for your sins. You will deny me three times. That has to be laying heavy on the heart of the apostle. Where does that memory go? I mean, you've walked with Christ. You love him with all your heart. You've walked across water because he's called you across water. You've You felt him strengthen you in your times of weakness and impulsiveness. You've seen him calm storms. You know that he loves you. You've heard his heart. You've heard his words, and you've seen him die on the cross. And now he's resurrected and standing right in front of you and feeding you sacrificially, servant-like, in front of you. And he asks you the question, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me with a heart and a commitment that's willing to sacrificially, unconditionally, and not looking for anything back, that will lay down that life for me? And that question lays on the table for us all to grapple with as believers in Christ, challenging us. We know that's the kind of love that can't happen from a human component. You can't muscle up agape love. I'm telling you, let me help somebody out just in case you think you can make that happen in and of your own strength. It's supernatural in its very essence and fundamentals, if you will. The only way you can love anybody, much less God, sacrificially, unconditionally, willing to lay down your life for the betterment of that person, is that God that Christ now lives in you. You've received him as your Lord and Savior, and you know the experience of what it's like to have the God-man to do the very thing that he's now commanding you or challenging you or empowering you to do. You can't do it by yourself. You would be frustrated even trying to do that by yourself. But for him to ask the question of Peter indicates that he's coming into that moment with him, and he's bringing the source of the strength needed. He's saying, I'm the one. You can only do that in and through me. Follow me. So he's letting Peter know at this very moment all of the sins, all the things you're struggling right now, son. I see it. You're wrestling with the fact that you've denied me three times. You're wrestling with all of these mistakes that you think you've made. The enemy would love to keep that on your back and on your shoulders, to keep you right at that place where you're now worried and wondering, and am I accepted by God? Can God forgive me for the things I've done wrong? Have I done so much and so bad and so long and been so grievous in my walk that God has turned his back on me? And God and Jesus comes along and basically says to him, my grace is sufficient for you. It's sufficient for you. And now we need to get on with not only recovering your faults, but clarifying your purpose and vision. Now, that's a rich and tender moment. It's a transformational moment. I don't know where you are in your journey. It's a personal moment. It may be one of those things where you may not get to tell anybody about that testimony, but it's a between you and Christ type of moment. It's a snuggle up next to him and know that he loves you enough that, number one, you can't keep it, and you're not giving him any information that he doesn't already know. So it's not like you're informing God of the things that you're bringing to the table. It's just a matter of coming in agreement. The text says if you confess your sins, God is faithful to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That means something to us. And he's walking Peter through the moment, and he's reinforcing to us as we journey in our journey that the same Christ that's calling us to lead by proclaiming this word is the same Christ that's gracious enough to give, provide mercy and give us grace. Justice, I heard. Justice is when God rightly gives us what we deserve. Y'all getting quiet on me. Y'all think I'm going somewhere. He's a just God. Mercy. You want to know why we get to shout when we get around the grace and mercy moment? Mercy. It's when you done messed up. Not just one time. You messed up. You look. It's one of those when I look back over my life, I can see a trail.
Look out.
A mess up. But somehow, church family, somehow God didn't give me the penalty that I deserve. If he were giving me justice, if I were operating totally under the just hand of God, I would not be living today because of the mess up in my life. But God was merciful, and he didn't reward me according to my messiness. That's called mercy. That's mercy. He didn't give me what I deserve to get. Anybody walking with me? I won't be long today. Anybody walking with me? Come on. I know I got some family in the house. And grace. Justice, mercy, and grace. If justice is giving me what I deserve, mercy is not giving me what I deserve in the way of the penalty for my messiness. Grace is blessing me with what I cannot earn and don't deserve. Mercy says you don't get the penalty that you deserve. Grace says, I'm going to step on top of that and not only not overly penalize you for your actions, I'm going to bless you just because I love you. Just because I love you. And you don't deserve it. You can't earn it. It's just because you're family. He comes to Peter, and he basically applies the principle to Peter in a very short conversation and helps him to understand that God's grace and mercy is more than enough in whatever situation that he's been through, going through right now, and will go through in the future. So he covers his faults with grace and mercy and clarifies his kingdom purpose and vision and says to him, feed my sheep and follow me. Now, finally, there's a little episode on the back end of this thing here that I just wanted to touch with my final life lesson. It picks up with verses, where did I stop off? I think it's 18 through 20. And he tells Peter in the Amplified, the King James is on the screen, I assure you, most solemnly I tell you, when you were young, you girded yourself, you put on your own belt, you walked about wherever you pleased to go, Amplified says. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will put a girdle around you and carry you where you do not wish to go. 19 says he said this to indicate by what kind of death Peter would glorify God. And after this, he said to him, follow me. Now, verse 20 says, but Peter had turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, that's John, following, who also had leaned back on his breast at the supper and had said, Lord, who is this? Lord, who is it that is going, leaned on his breast when he said, Lord, who is it that's going to betray you? When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man?
It's so beautiful how they put this in the scripture. They just don't leave it out, do they?
And Jesus says to him, if I have him to stay or survive or live till I come, what is that to you?
What concern is it of yours? You follow me.
Don't you love this Savior that we have? My final life lesson. We'll move to communion. When Christ calls us to lead, he strengthens our faith in his power, protection, and plan. And he redirects our focus away from destructive comparisons. Sound like I'm about to meddle. To decisive commitment to him. Redirects our focus away from destructive comparisons to decisive commitment to him. He's not finished with Peter. He's moving Peter not only from understanding the preparation, he and the disciples understanding the preparation that has been made. He's now about to leave, ascend to be at the right hand of the Father, and they will be carrying the torch. He's passing the banner on to them. They will be the disciples who will now carry the word along with others of the saving grace of Jesus Christ and the importance of the walk and the newness of new creatures in Christ Jesus. And he's built into these men. He's shown them the heart of God, pulling up a seat beside them, serving them. He's shown them what service looks like. He's shown them what his power looks like. He's shown them what his wisdom looks like. And he's now got them, he's intimately set beside Peter, and he's restored him to let him know what grace and mercy looks like. And so that you know that you're not in this journey by yourself, that it's by the power of God that you're able to do what you're about to do. And then he not only shows him the preparation and the purpose, he shows him prophetically what will happen in the future. He gives him a glimpse of his future. He says, man, don't get your head all wrapped up into the days. Don't get all wrapped up into the days when you used to be young and spry and you thought you could do all this stuff in and of your own strength. Don't get all excited about those days, Peter, when you thought you could get out there fishing and catch all kinds of fish. Or the moments even when you got impetuous and walked out on water and when you thought that you were the kingfish among the disciples. He said, don't get your head all wrapped up in that stuff, because back in that day, you were young and you could leap up and you could dunk that ball into the rim. You could toss that football 60, 70 yards across the field. He said, Peter, but that was back in the day. He says, there's going to come a day, young brother, when your knees won't bend like they used to. You won't have that spring in your legs like you used to. You may be going around telling folk what you used to do back in the day, but you know, you won't be able to leap tall buildings with a single bound. Those stories will be your war stories back in the day. He said, there come a day when you'll have to lift up your arms like this, and there'll be folk who will be putting girdles around. They'll have to dress you. And a matter of fact, they won't be just dressing you to take care of you. He said, they're going to be dressing you because you, in spite of the fact that you want them to. In other words, the reality is, Peter, you're going to get to the point in life where you're going to be in bondage. And Roman guards will have to gird you up. And they'll be preparing to take you to give your very life for me. But don't miss this in the story, in the statement here. The statement said, they'll carry you where you do not wish to go. But 19 says, but he said this not only to indicate what kind of death Peter would experience, but it says, he said this in Amplified to indicate what kind of death Peter would glorify the Lord. If you missed that, you'd have missed the whole meat of that. Don't miss that. So he tells them, yeah, you're going to go. Don't wrap yourself all up in your history, because the future, you're going to do great things, and it's going to cost you on this side of the realm. But this side of the realm is not the end of the realm. You need to understand that the earth existence is only a part of the story, because what you're going to be doing will be God will glorify God in your service. And we'll pass on an image and a message that will go down through the ages. And oh, by the way, God's got his reward system in place, because someday every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus indeed is Lord. And you shall be in glory with me. You shall glorify God. Help me out, somebody. If you're worrying about the struggles that we're going through down here, the Lord has a message for you, that even in your pain and even in your struggles, even in our journey, God is able to make that come to his glory and somehow mysteriously work out for your good. That's above my pay grade. I can't get. And then, as if that wasn't a Peter, I'm trying to imagine this moment. Peter's still Peter. Peter's still Peter. Help me out. Peter looks over at John, the one who lays his, I love the way John sneaks this in. He doesn't stick his name in. He says, the disciple that Jesus loved. the disciple that laid his head on Jesus' breast.
when he says, who's going to deny me? That disciple. He looks over there and says, wait a minute, now you just, what about that brother? Pastor paraphrase. You just finished telling me, you know, not to get my head all wrapped up in how many points I scored back in the day. And that I'm going to be going through in this service, I'm going to lay down my life with a struggle, but it's to the glory of God. I said, well, what's going to happen to him? Pastor's paraphrase. And what this gives us insight into, family, this is what I love about how the scriptures just kind of lay it out raw for us to experience and grow from. What that tells us is how the human mindset tends to flow. And we get ourselves all caught up into comparisons, even when we don't try to get caught up in comparisons, and how that can lead to a destructive component. Jesus is basically saying to him, well, now, wait a minute, don't worry about that, brother. Why are you worrying about that? That's his business, and it's going to take all of your energy to live your life. Pastor's paraphrase. Thank you, Deacon. While your mind is all wrapped up in whether that person just got a new job, or that person just got a new house, or that person just got a new car, or that person showed up in a nice new dress or a nice new suit, you know, Jesus said, well, now, why is that your business? And in that short statement, he's primarily letting Peter know that, let's walk this up, walk this forward, in ministry, in life, in living life, and certainly in conducting ministry, because of our sin nature, our tendency is to, in our self-interest and self-focus, I'll just take a moment because I know you don't want me to stay here long. There is a tendency, there is a built-in sin tendency to be eye-focused. And when we are, because we are eye-focused, the tendency is to, no matter how much you have or how little you have, the tendency is to look over and see what somebody else has. And then say, well, Lord, how come that brother got that? Well, let me go over this side. am I preaching? Send me home if I'm not. We know the tendency is to look over there and then we have the audacity every now and then to complain to God, like, well, God, you... I'm going to read between the lines here with Peter. The tendency, he looks over there and sees John over there. John minding his business. John ain't got nothing to do with this conversation. John over there doing what John does, you know. You know, I'm the disciple that the Lord loves. Over here doing his thing, and Peter calls him out. Peter calls him out. It's like, Lord, you've been on me long enough here. You know, you done called me out three times. You've been on me long enough. What about this brother over here? And the Lord is working and grooming and preparing him. And the tendency inside of us is to get caught up with what's going on the sideshow. What's going on in somebody else's life? What's going on in their journey? And the enemy can play in this ground so quickly when we open up the door and let him in. Because it's not just that we get comparing about, well, now, how come you got that and I don't have that. And the enemy will now play in that ground, and we'll start getting bitter about what we don't have. We'll start looking at our life. Talk to me, somebody. We'll start looking at our life, and we begin to see it. Now, that glass is either half empty or half full, depending on how you see it. When you start that destructive comparison stuff, that glass will never be full. It can never be full. So if you fill it up to the rim, somebody else will have two glasses over there. And you say, well, wait a minute, Lord.
And then we find out, man, I'm staying here longer than I thought I would. I'm going to close. And then because the psychology of that thing is that you can never satisfy a fleshly lust. Lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, pride of life, you just can't satisfy it. The enemy will play there and we'll find ourselves running down that pathway and we can never experience. It blunts the joy of our salvation that God has built into us. And while we're being blessed from God, he's pouring down on us all these mighty blessings, and he's filling up our glass with all the things he's doing in our lives. We never can get satisfied because we think that somehow we're missing something. We think that somehow God is keeping something from us. We think that somehow he likes that person more than he likes us, and therefore he's blessing them with more stuff than he's blessing us with. And we get angry, the enemy will take us down the road of getting angry at God and angry at other folk and judgmental in our thinking. And we're not going to be happy unless misery has found a way to make everybody else around us miserable. And so Jesus is saying to Peter, you don't even want to go down that road, son. Don't even start down that road. Said, what is that to you? And so he strengthens our faith with his power, protection, and plan, and then redirects us because he loves us. And the hand cannot be filled up with his blessing when we're closing it, trying to hold on to stuff that we think is ours, or trying to keep stuff from somebody else, or trying to hoard stuff that, you know, we get into the mammon thing, loving the mammon thing. And, you know, this is a little bit of a tough note to close the message on, because I ain't going to make you shout on that one. Until you begin to think about how good and gracious God is. Until you begin to reflect on how he has protected us, you and me, from things that we thought were good to us, but were not good for us. And he not only protected us from those, he then moved us to the things that are the better blessing for us. And he says, now, I'm not giving it to you to hoard, I'm giving it to you to be a blessing. And then, as if to reflect us back, he said, now remember, I just finished feeding you, man. I just finished giving you the fish. I just cooked it up, fried it up for you, threw a little bread on the side. Didn't have no greens today, but, you know. I served it up, fed you, cared for you, loved you, and now I'm saying, that's more than enough. Our God is more than enough. And when you begin to move out of the disciplinary moment into the abundance moment, you begin to see just how God is now opening up the windows of heaven and pouring out grace and mercy and love and things on you that you won't have. Wait a minute. You won't have room enough to receive. He said, don't worry about the comparisons, because you could, just a few minutes ago, you couldn't even drag that net of fish up on the shoreline. Talk to me, somebody. He's given you a whole net of fish that is way beyond anything you can handle in and by yourself. Don't even waste your time looking up to see if anybody else has got a net like yours. We're about to have some fun doing what God has called us to do in a fresh new way. And I just thank God that he's allowed us to spend just a little time. I love Peter. I love that brother. Just to walk with him through the journey and see how he has called us to lead. We're going to stand. You can start moving them this way. But let me just pray, and we're going to close out and move to our communion. Father God, thank you for this day, for this time as family together. Thank you, Lord, for equipping us through your word and walking with us lovingly and caringly. Thank you, Lord, for just giving us a passion to share this good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ with loving boldness and prayerfully clear. And then, Lord, continue to move in our lives and help us to grow and experience each and everything that you have for us, and knowing that you've got an even better place for us up in glory. In Jesus' name we pray. In his holy, precious name we pray. Let all God's people say amen. The doors of the church are open. As we stand together, we want to extend this invitation to you as our new members, directors, members come. To come and become a part of the Trinity family. If you're seeking a church family, a church home, can we invite you today to come and become a part of our family? The doors of the church are open. The arms of the family are extended. Says all the way. I'm going all the way. The Lord is speaking to your heart. Won't you take that step of faith today? Won't you come forward and just let us introduce you as new members, new family. All the way. The doors of the church are open. The invitation to membership is extended. Made my choice. Lord, I'm going all the way. Have you made your choice today? We're going all the way. Sharing the communion service, the scriptures share with us that during the Passion Week, on the week prior to Christ stretching out his arms and giving his life on the cross for your sins and for mine, he gathers in Jerusalem in an upper room there celebrating the Passover. He takes the bread and he breaks it and blesses it. This is my body, which is given, which is broken for you. Eat ye of it. Likewise, he takes the cup, and having blessed it, said, this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of your sins. Every one of them. As often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you show forth my death till I come again. First Sunday of each month, we come together as family, believers in Christ Jesus. And we share in this worship of communion, reflecting on God's grace and his mercy, thanking him for loving us so much that he would give his only begotten Son. Recommitting ourselves to walk with him, in him, share the good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So as you bow your heads, we ask you, and we begin to distribute the cups, we, as for a moment of prayer, we ask that you hold your elements until all are served. Father God, we thank you for this another glorious day in which we can come together as your family and lift our voices, our hands, our hearts in praise. Coming before you in prayer, sharing in fellowship, hearing and integrating your word into our being and our lives. As we prepare to enter back into this world setting, where serving you can truly take place. Thank you, Lord, for preparing us and loving us. And bless these elements that all that we're about to receive. Bless us as we receive them, Lord. And strengthen our heart for the journey ahead. In the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray it all. Amen and amen.
Trust him, he'll never. Savior, Jesus, will never, never, never fail.
Representing the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us eat. Representing the blood of our Lord and Savior, shed for the remission of your sins. Let's drink together. Scriptures say that after they had shared the Passover meal, went out to the Mount of Olives, singing a hymn. As we recover the used cups, let's prepare now to close out our time together in worship. Praise God. Benedictory prayer. You're invited to come join us if you have time, would like to, in the chapel for our annual vision and business meeting. Taking your neighbor by the hand. Yes, bet you have someone near you. With our heads bowed and with our eyes closed.
our hearts humbled before the living God, assuming an attitude of prayer as we lift our hands to Him in praise. Now unto Him who is able to keep you and me from falling, and present us faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. Now, henceforth, and forevermore, let all God's people say amen and amen. Oh.